miracles happen, eh?
Responsibility for food, protection.
just a whole lot of privilege and stuff, and honors and cup positions, you know, in order to, so it was called as deliverer. But I don't see, how do y'all feel about being responsible for 2.5 hours to a meeting? It's a job of dealing with a handful.
Yeah.
But, you know, I guess he had to be called. He had to be anointed, you know.
Yeah.
And the grace of God had to be upon him. Anytime you're called to do something like that, you have to have a special grace to carry that out. Just not an ordinary grace or anointing that you can operate in those types of positions of responsibility. Moses was a great man, and so we just got through discussing what do you consider the greatest indications of Moses' complete surrender to the will of God. Okay, now we talk about Moses, since we know that, what is the greatest indication of our complete surrender, of our complete surrender to God, to the will of God? Speak on that. What are some of the things that would enable a person to see your complete surrender to the will of God? Anybody got a chance to be rich? A lot of time with him, easier for you to just talk school, got a job, worked, or even travel as they did. It's typically easier than this. But we felt like God had called us to pastor. And a lot of things that really sometimes really cause a lot of stress you have to experience being a pastor. So, it's a lot easier doing a whole lot of other things. You know, women that whose spouses are not involved in ministry, they don't have to experience nearly the pressure that a pastor has involved in. Pastor, carried out those types of roles. So that does require some degree of surrender to the will of God, because it would be a lot easier to make it easy on your flesh. Every Sunday, Sister Hilda, I do this. My sister Hilda. Prayer meeting, my sister Hilda. If I miss, a few times, I wonder where am I? Sometimes I ask, where are y'all? Where art thou? Y'all going through a lot. Now just think about your desire just to everybody to pray and get a breakthrough. Everybody have free and delivered and blessed and built up. And sometimes you can't get people to amen. Sometimes you really won't get people. So he'll always say this. That was she always. You want more for people than they want for themselves. So you set yourself up for disappointment when you want more for them than they want for themselves. So, everybody's different. Some people don't want as much as others, so therefore they don't have a commitment. But Moses is a good example, and I think that if we could follow, the scripture says, "Be ye followers of God as your children." And Moses was one of those men of God that really followed the will of God, and he reminds me a lot of Christ. Everybody that's successful and blessed, and God raised up to do a major, to play a major role in the kingdom of God, they all are of that same caliber. Joseph. What did he have to go through, Joseph?
In prison.
He went through a lot, right? Now, first thing in his home, his brothers despised him.
Yes.
And sometimes, we were teaching the young kids in his morning. I know that he was the father, Joseph was the son of his father's old age. That was, he loved him more than the others, right?
Right.
And also, he made him a coat of many colors. That was a source. Both of those were sources of contention. But a lot of the contention that existed against Joseph was due to the fact that Jacob made a lot of his sins, and Jacob had to marry Leah first. That was a trick.
Yeah.
By what? Laban.
Yeah.
He worked 7 years thinking that he was going to get what?
Rachel.
And then they said it's a tradition that if the daughter first, the oldest daughter, has to be married first before the younger daughter. So you got to work 7 more years.
Yeah.
he wanted the younger daughter, which the one that he really loved. He thought he was working for the one that he really liked. For 7 years, and he found out that those 7 years was not for her, it was for the one that he didn't want. So he said, 7 more years. And then you can see why there was so much contention in that family, because some of the children were conceived by Leah, only two by Rachel, which was the woman that he really loved. That was Joseph and Benjamin.
Right.
And then he had some by his what? His concubines or maids?
Maidservant.
So he had some of those sons by them. So it was a lot of contention in that house. You know how envious it would be in a household. He had all of those different women, and all of them were vying for the attention from Jacob. Well, it was a lot of bitterness and envy and jealousy and strife. And no wonder those boys came up to be so violent, and they were really some evil guys, but they learned it right there in the home from all of the contention and dissension and strife that existed among all of those women. But how Joseph turned out to be so different, I guess maybe he might, you know, sometimes kids of certain seed, you know, turn out better than others. But Joseph was exposed, I guess, to all of the animosity, the hostility, right? But he wasn't full of revenge and hostility and hatred. And the others were. So what do you attribute that to?
Predestination.
Yeah, that's probably a lot of it, predestination.
Right there.
I feel that Joseph probably heeded the instructions of his father. And the others probably were so contentious and so full of hostility, probably they had no interest in what their father was trying to what, teach them. And I asked the little boy this morning, I said, do you have any idea of how difficult it might be for kids in homes where there's a lot of contention? Maybe the father might be absent, maybe it's a common law relationship, maybe they're constantly fighting. I said, do you have any reason why it would be a lot more difficult for a person from that background to be able to relate to whatever is happening in the class? And, you know, some of them, you know, most of those, they can relate. You know, just like my grandson, they can relate. They didn't have, you know what I was talking about. But, that did require a special call, a special grace on the part of Joseph, because he had to go through a whole lot to get beyond all of the hostility that was focused on him. It was a great price and a great pay. They, you know, all of the madness that they tried to pull through in the pit, sat down and started partying, I guess, after they threw him in a pit, and you know, knew that if they left him there, he would die. And they sat down and ate. Sat down and parted and celebrated. Then somebody thought, oh, let's throw him out. There's no point. We might as well throw him out and sell him. At least we can get a little something for him. And they got 20 pieces of silver. But he went through a lot. And they, can you imagine those rascals? Told their dad, well, they insinuated, I don't know whether they told them a flat out lie or not, they insinuated. When the boys got back home and Joseph went with them, so they had killed a what? A goat?
Killed some animal.
Yeah, and dipped that blood, that color, that quarter of it comes in that blood,
yeah.
So they would give the impression to their father that he had been torn apart by a beast. And his father grieved over that for about 13 years. And they didn't tell him no better. You know, those boys were really vicious guys. Y'all remember the guy, Judah, who had all of those guys circumcised in that city.
Yes.
And then I think, you know, because I think Dinah, she got raped by one of the officials, right? And you went to marry her, and the boy said, well, the only way you can marry her, we have to get everybody circumcised. And he went on, he was willing to get everybody circumcised. And when they got him circumcised, what did he do? Kill them all.
Kill them all.
Because all of them have no strength, all of them were weak.
Yeah.
And Joseph had to stand up under all of that old stuff. But yet he survived, and they kept pushing him down, but he kept what? Rising back up, just like the beach ball. You try to push it underwater. And that's the way it was with Moses. Every time he got pushed down, what?
He
rose back up. You call him out, you call him God. Amen. If God be for you, amen. Who shall be against you? Derek always said, he said, one day of favor is worth a thousand years of labor. One bit of favor from God is worth a thousand years of labor. If God be for you, it doesn't matter who's against you. You're always going to rise up to the top. Read that, Brother Joe? So when you know all that, when you know all that up front, you don't mind laying down your life. Is that right? But if you didn't know all of that, it would be kind of hard. But we do know it, although we might not have experienced it all, but the Bible tells us, amen, we forsake all and deny ourselves. He said that we'll be blessed in this life. We'll have to be blessed with houses, land, children, wives, and all of that. All right, we talked on that too long. Let's go to number two. All right, how did Moses show his faith and total dependency upon the Lord? Who wants to be in charge of that one? How did Moses show his faith and total dependency upon the Lord? This is, I guess, all through the wilderness experience. How did Moses show his faith and total dependency upon the Lord?
Moses made a decision to respond to God's call, and Moses trusted God wholeheartedly, and his fervency in prayer and compassion for Israel, because he had to do a lot of praying and a lot of believing.
Cool. Anybody want to name some of those stunts the children of Israel pulled that Moses had to fall to the ground and pray and get through it?
One time he went up there, they took the golden, made a golden calf, idols and stuff, dancing all, just clowning, drinking, everything. It showed out real bad.
Right, they sure did.
That's when he threw the tablets at him, right? He was so mad with them.
Right.
They go rock. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And they showed it. And they was just, I guess an example of people today, God kept showing them miracles after miracles after miracles and bringing them through, and they was Constantly complaining.
That was got my nerve back. I don't know about these, when they came down from the mountain and saw the wish of the golden calf. I know some of those things are a lot of idolatry was connected with it. A lot of sexual things were involved. They were committed having sex, fornication, adultery.
And they had even talked, Miriam them was in on it too, wasn't it? I mean, they went along with it, didn't they?
They separated themselves, didn't they?
He
kind of separated himself away from it. He didn't want to get killed in other words.
Yeah,
he was
right.
Scared of.
Right. Yep, Aaron was kind of weak. He always gave in to pressure and popular demand and all of that. So the call wasn't on him, and the call really was on Moses.
Yeah.
Okay, name some more events that took place throughout the wilderness experience that really caused Moses to really lean on God to get him through. sick, I'm sick of this man. Sick of this. Every time I got to eat, I got to eat this man. I'm sick of him. So they prayed and asked God for what? Me. God did what?
He sent the birds.
Quail with bears, quail, quails. We got, I think so many baskets of quails per person. Since Japan, I mean, they ate so many quails. Quails was coming out of their nostrils. The Bible says that he fed them to the full and turned around and he slew them.
Not before 14,000, 14 million, 7,000, I guess, additional people. care, so a lot of people died.
Yeah, right. That's so true. That was that was numbers, what, 16?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Number 16, 45 to 49.
Okay, let me just read a little bit of this in number 16. Now Korah, that's the name I was, he was the chief leader, the son of Izhar, the son of Kohar, the son of Levi. This we are at number 16. This is number 16, verse 1. Abram, and it was Korah, Dathan, and Abram. Those were the main leaders. They rose up before Moses with certain of the children of Israel, 250 princes of the assembly. These were the leaders, famous in the congregation, men of renown. All of these men stood up against Moses. These three main leaders and 250 princes of the assembly, famous in the congregation, men of renown. And they gathered themselves together against Moses and against Aaron, and said unto them, ye take too much upon you, seeing all the congregation are holy, every one of them, and the Lord is among them. Wherefore then lift up ye yourselves above the congregation of the Lord. In other words, they were challenging the right for Moses them to exert authority over them, because they felt like everybody, all of them, holy and equally as good, not really realizing that Moses was God's anointed. And he had been authorized to do that, but they didn't get it. And when Moses heard it, he fell on his face. And he spake unto Korah and unto all his company, saying, even tomorrow the Lord will show who are his and who is holy, and will cause him to come near unto him, even him whom he hath chosen will he cause to come near unto him. This do, take ye censers, Korah, and all of his company, and put fire therein, and put incense in them before the Lord tomorrow. And it shall be that the man whom the Lord doth choose, he shall be holy. Ye take too much upon ye, you, you sons of Levi. So God, Moses was challenging them. He said, well, y'all come with your senses and we're going to see tomorrow. God is going to show, amen, who is holy, who's the one that his hands are on, the one that he has called. And Moses said unto Korah, here I pray you, you sons of Levi, seemeth it but a small thing unto you that the God of Israel hath separated you from the congregation of Israel to bring you near to himself to do the service of the tabernacle of the Lord, and to stand before the congregation to minister to them. And he hath brought thee near to him, and all thy brethren, the sons of Levi with thee. And seek ye the priesthood also? Okay, so Moses challenged them. He said, you've already been, you've called to perform the service of the tabernacle. And that was the Levites' role anyway.
Yeah.
And then he said that you weren't content with what God had called you to do, and now you seek the priesthood also? For which cause both thou and all thy company are gathered together against the Lord, and what is Aaron that ye murmur against him? And Moses went to call Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab, which said, we will not come up. That's the other leaders, the other two leaders. Moses called them, and they said, what? We ain't coming.
Mm-hmm.
Moses called them now, they didn't say what? We ain't coming.
Mm-hmm.
So they were really full of pride, full of the devil too. It is a small thing that thou hast brought us up. Here's what their complaint. Is it a small thing that thou hast brought us out of the land that floweth with what, milk and honey, to kill us in the wilderness, except thou make thyself altogether our prince over us? Moreover, thou hast not brought us into a land that floweth with milk and honey, or given us inheritance of fields and vineyards with Will thou put out the eyes of these men? We will not come up. See how they talking to Moses?
Mm-hmm.
How you like the tone of that conversation? It's a bad sign, man. And Moses was very wroth. You can see why he was very mad. And said unto the Lord, respect not thou their offering. I have not taken one ass from them, neither have I hurt one of them. And Moses said unto Korah, be thou and all thy company before the Lord, thou and they and Aaron tomorrow. And take every man his censer and put incense in them, and bring ye before the Lord every man his censer, 250 censers, thou also and Aaron, each of you his censer. So he challenged all of these people to come with their censers tomorrow. So this is going to be a showdown, look like to me, a showdown. And they took every man his censer, put fire in him, laid incense thereon, and stood on the door of the tabernacle of the congregation with Moses and Aaron. And Korah gathered all the congregation against them unto the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And the glory of the Lord appeared unto all the congregation. And the Lord spake unto Moses and unto Aaron, saying, separate yourselves from among this congregation, that I may consume them in a moment. They fell on their faces and said, O God, the God of the spirits of all flesh, shall one man sin, and wilt thou be wroth with all the congregation? And the Lord spake unto Moses, speak unto the congregation, saying, get you up from about the tabernacle of Korah, Dathan and Abiram. And Moses rose up and went into Dathan and Abiram, and the elders of Israel followed him. And he spake unto the congregation, said, depart, I pray you, from the tents of these wicked men, and touch nothing of theirs, lest ye be consumed in all of their sin. And so they got up from the tabernacle of Korah, Dathan and Abiram, on every side, and Dathan and Abiram came out and stood in the door of their tents, and their wives, and their sons, and their little ones. All right, just Korah, Dathan and Abiram, okay, those three main leaders, I guess, and all of those people that were following them. And Moses said, hereby ye shall know that the Lord has sent me to do all these works, for I have not done them of mine own man. If these men die the common death of all men, or if they be visited after the visitation of all men, then the Lord hath not sent me. But if the Lord make a new thing and the earth upon her mouth, and swallow them up with all that appertain unto them, and they go down quick into the pit, then ye shall understand that these men have provoked the Lord. And it came to pass, as he made an end of speaking all these words, that the ground clave asunder that was under them, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up, and their houses, and all the men that appertain unto Korah and all their goods, and all of those 250 princes, the ringleaders and all of their followers went down. The Lord just opened up a hole, and the earth swallowed them up. And that said, Bible says, touch not my anointing.
That's right.
Do my prophets no harm. But they went down. And so later on, people came to Moses. He said, Lord, you killed the Lord's people. They came to Moses and Aaron, murmuring, you just killed the Lord's people. And they were ready to stone them again for killing the Lord's people. And that's when the Lord got very wroth with the people. And God was about to wipe them all out. It was Aaron that stood between the people and the dead, because 14,000 had already died. The Lord just what caused the plague to break out. When they approached Moses and trying to condemn him for accuse him of killing all these people, then the Lord got very mad. So the Lord just suffered a plague to break out. 14,000 just went like that. And Aaron had to offer up a offer up a sacrifice, atonement, to appease God's wrath, but not before 14 dollars. Moses hadn't offered up that atonement. All of them had been wiped out. Amen. So, and they admit God don't play them. You might think he played, but God is serious. Okay, so Moses had a whole lot to contend with. That was just one of these big incidents. I think that we touched on many others. But all through the lesson, we see different instances where Moses had to bow down and pray. He had to really labor for the Lord, prostrate. And I think that in this lesson somewhere, it mentioned about how many times he fell prostrate on his face before the Lord, praying. Yes, in the back.
Earlier said that all that God commanded Moses to do were carefully performed, just as the Lord had commanded Moses, and the only exception was his disobedience, which kept him from entering the promised land.
Okay, page 20, that's very good. Page 20 and 21. I like to read this because it's very short. Moses received the law, divers statutes, and God's covenant for Israel. He was given detailed and careful instructions for the holy erection of the tabernacle and operation of the priesthood and for the operation of an efficient system of government. All of those details are found in what Exodus, Leviticus, and you know, all through there. And sometimes it gets kind of grievous trying to digest all of that when you read the Bible through it. All the little intricate points, detail, it was made, and give you the dimensions of everything, the color of it, the material, and fabric, and all that kind of stuff. And God gave Moses all of that detailed information. And it had to be made exactly like God gave it to him. Otherwise, God would have rejected it. It could have been judgment. All right, now, the reason why God gave him all of these careful instructions, very detailed and careful, for the tabernacle, for the priesthood, for the system of government, details concerning various sacrifices. How many have read in Leviticus about all of these different sacrifices and the instructions and the way that they had to offer them up? Laws for holy living. They had laws for everything. Every type of sickness and disease. People that committed all different kinds of sin. How to deal with them. They had laws concerning every aspect of their system. Okay, now, the observance of feasts. How many know there was a whole lot of laws dealing with just feasts? Okay, now, the reason why God gave them all of these laws was because God wanted to set them apart as a holy nation, and they were to be what? Holy, amen, and set apart unto God. Amen. So, the book of Leviticus and Exodus 21 through 24 focus on all of these laws, the observance of these feasts, and all of the things that they had to institute in order for them to be a separate people unto the Lord. Now, number two, all the things that God commanded Moses to do were carefully performed. His obedience and submission to the Lord was unquestionable. The phrase, just as the Lord had commanded Moses, pertaining to his diligence and strict adherence in following every detailed instructions given by the Lord, appears at least 17 times in Exodus chapters 39 and 40. Just in those two chapters alone, the phrase, just Moses carried out God's commandment just as the Lord had what? Commanded him. That appears 17 times. Now, what does that say about Moses? All right, he was very what?
Particular.
Yes. Precise. He wanted to do it exactly like God had spoken to him. Now, what is that saying to us today? You know, Jesus said, I always do those things that what please my Father. I always, I mean, he didn't say it when it was convenient, when I felt like it, when I wasn't too sick and tired, when I wasn't down and depressed. tell, I always do those things that please my Father. That's where the blessings come in, when we bring ourselves to the point of always submitting to the will of our Father. Amen. Praise God. Well, sometimes we might say, well, I can't do everything God tells me to do. I just have to pick and choose. I can't do everything. How do y'all feel about that? How do y'all feel about that? I can't do everything that God said. All these commandments, we're kind of Lord. You think from Genesis to Revelation? What's the secret, y'all? What's the secret?
Pray.
Pray. Right. You pray and pray and pray and pray. Is that the secret? It might be part of the answer, but that's not the main thing. I don't think that we even ought to even attempt to try do all everything, like I said. I think that we should adopt the attitude that I can do all things through Christ. I can't do it. But the what?
Christ, the
grace of God that He has given me. Yeah. He has given me that grace for that what? Purpose. If we could just find out the main thing, we have to find out how can we tap into the grace that God has given us in order what? To please God.
And God wants this one good thing, the true one thing is obedience.
Right.
By being obedient to God, you really receive favor a lot. Yeah, just by being obedient.
Right. So obedience is the main thing. It's a cardinal virtue, but we don't have the ability to obey unless we depend entirely on the what? Grace of God. Amen, the grace of God. Amen, the grace of God. Now, y'all know how you receive grace. The Bible says that God resists the proud, but He gives grace to the what? Okay, you have to what? Be humble. Amen. You have to be willing to, the Bible says that, it says submit yourself to God. And resist the devil, and he will what? Flee from you. So we have to submit to God in order to be to place ourselves in a position where God's grace can what? Can reach us. How many believe that?
Yeah.
Amen. Humble means, I heard somebody say that humility means to withdraw from your own way. Yield to God's way. Withdraw from your way, or retire from your way, and yield to God's way. So if a person is humble and they are all together, Lord, I don't have what it takes. I don't have the ability, Lord, to go forth. Lord, I don't know what to do. Lord, all of my help, I'm trusting you to lead me, guide me, direct me, to keep me. Lord, my life is in your hands. Lord, I acknowledge you, and you got to direct me. When a person is completely dependent on God, then they're going to get a lot of help. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So God resists the proud, and He does give grace to what? Another thing that gives grace, name another virtue that really causes God's grace to release in your life. There's several of them. Just like I was speaking today about living holy, if a person knew how easy it is to live holy and to perfectly carry out the will of God. You know, for instance, like sanctification, you know, God says, have nothing to do with the unfruitful works of darkness, but reprove them. God said, come out from among them and be separated. God said, depart from evil, resist temptation. He says that, abstain from fleshly lust. So, God is saying that you always separate yourself when you find yourself in a predicament or in an environment that you could very easily be tempted to what? To yield or to be what? Seduced or to be enticed. That means no intimate relationships with people that are not saved. You can't be a friend of the world. Mike said, you're a friend of the world, you're enemy what to God. So you have to separate yourself from evil influence, evil people, and that is a major step toward living a holy life. If you're not around people that's cursing and talking vulgar languages, right? And
gossiping and lying. That's the tongue.
Right. So, you know, if you're around that environment at your work, you just try to what? You know, try to find another environment.
Yeah. Separate yourself.
You just can't hang around people that don't have the same mindset you have.
Yeah.
And, a lot of people like to go to movies and things, you know, that's fine. A lot of time, a lot of vulgarity comes from the movie. They use a lot of cursing in movies.
Yeah, a whole lot more.
Yeah, and sometimes when you get back home and start reading your Bible, some of those curse words will pop in your what?
Mind. In your mind, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So the Bible says, shun evil, stay away. Don't place yourself in a position where you can be what contaminated by the things of the world. That's a big step. Then the Bible says, don't yield your members as the instruments of unrighteousness unto sin. That's easy. If you always are using your members to what? To do things to glorify God, amen, then you're not going to light up a cigarette. He said, don't use your members. Wait a minute. Do not use your members as instruments of what? Of unrighteousness unto sin. Do not use your members. In order to get a cigarette, one just said a cigarette, it could be the same thing with some. The casino. Somebody else said, that ain't no sin. But I thought we were supposed to be what? Staying away from the what? That kind of influence, our atmosphere, our environment. Because things are going to what? Pull you in, and you ain't going to change them. Get up, put your clothes on, and go out to your car, start your car up, and go and what? Get the very thing that you're having struggles with, mm-hmm. overcome. Some said, well, I just don't have the willpower. Well, why don't you try this? I can do all things through Christ that what strengthens me. Now, suppose people would practice these confessions and begin to, we call it affirm what God clearly says we are, or He has done for us, or what we have. I believe that a lot of the temptations that we confront will just what? Go away. It'll just disappear. Because the Word of God is going to be a lot stronger than what the temptation is. But I think that the thing that causes us to fall short, very few of us, when the time that we are tempted to get off track, many times we do not use words, words that will neutralize the impact of what Satan is trying to do. Those words do not come out of our mouths. And that's where the power is. Jesus said, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are what? Life. The power of life and death is in what?
The tongue.
The upright, the tongue of the upright shall what? Deliver them. That's where the power is. Whenever you're dealing with something and you don't want that thing to overcome you, if you don't want to be overruled by that, you're going to have to get something coming out of your mouth that will neutralize that. The Word of God is sharp and it is what? Quick. It will what? Pull down whatever stronghold that the enemy is coming after you. Amen. So, when people say, I can't live for God, that means that they don't know who they are in Christ. They don't know what they have. They don't know nothing about the grace of God. And they certainly don't know the power of confession or the power of agreement. When you hook up with what God says and begin to what, say the same thing as God says, strength is going to come from somewhere. You don't have to say it. Amen. Anyway.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Y'all agree with that?
Amen.
All right, let's move on further. We got one more, a couple more. Describe the event, describe the extent of Moses' commitment to prayer, seen in the various wilderness experiences. We have already done that, let's move on. What was Moses' attitude towards suffering for the Lord and Israel say? All right, what was his attitude? So Moses was willing, that was right, that Moses was willing to suffer affliction, is that right, with the people of God and to go through all that he went through, then to enjoy the pleasures of what? Sin for a season. That was Moses' attitude. Look, now look at page 23. Looking at Moses' attainments and successes, how numerous they were. Moses could have picked the big life, I mean the high profile type life. He could have enjoyed all of the wealth that Egypt had to offer. He could have been all of the power and the privileges. All of the titles that he desired. He could have been probably even the king of the entire country. He probably was in position to be the next king. Okay, but he felt that wasn't what God was saying to him. This is what the scripture says here. Choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. Amen. For he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. So he knew one day God was going to what? Pay him pay. That was going to be a reward. Amen. He dead respect, and that God always rewards people that will work, that will serve him. For faith, not faith, he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him is invisible. Now, on page 23, on the other hand, Moses' attainments and successes were numerous. See how God blessed him. He was Israel's deliverer, lawgiver, ruler, and greatest prophet. After how many years was that? He served God. See, he came out of, he started his work when he was 80 years old, is that right? And he led Israel at the to the brink of the promised land, is that right? So he was almost like 40 years. So Moses must have been about 40 when he died. Is that right? So 40 years, he served as Israel's leader. And he was Israel's greatest prophet. See, he was the meekest man, which were upon the face of the earth, and was highly respected and revered by Israel. People also, all generations, speak of Moses as a great prophet in what? Lawgiver. He was a man of fearless faith who held steadfast to his call and purpose by seeing him who was invisible. He was permitted to see a limited view of God's glory after praying that God to show him his way and his glory. All right, he's about the only one that probably have had that limited view of God's glory. All right, McDonald's Transfiguration, those that saw that. He and his writings were spoken of and referred to many times by the prophets, kings, Jesus, the apostles, etc. He was regarded as the most commanding and dominant figure of the Old Testament and the mediator of the Old Covenant. Moses, a type of Christ, knew the ways of God and manifested the glory of God. God's nature and his ways were revealed to Israel and to the nation through Moses' faithfulness and obedience. Moses has a tremendous track record, and when you look back over what all Moses went through and all that he suffered, all of the sacrifices he made, amen, you might want to ask the question, was it worth it? Was it worth it? What do y'all say? Was it worth it to Moses? Okay, if it hadn't been for Moses, we never would have been. I mean, the Bible says, the law came by Moses, but grace and truth by what? Jesus Christ. So the grace and truth was able to be revealed because of the inadequacy of the law. So it had been for that foundation that was laid, amen, Jesus Christ wouldn't have had anything to build. Amen. Praise God. Build his house of God. Amen. So Jesus talked a whole lot about Moses. Moses was a great man of God. So, but sometimes people look at the two or three mistakes that Moses made. Anybody remember those two mistakes that Moses
one
made?
One was hitting the rock.
Yeah.
What did he do to that rock?
He split it. Because he was angry.
What made him so angry? All right, so God told him to what? Speak to the rock?
Speak to the rock.
Speak to the rock. And Moses what? Because he was thinking about somebody that was causing him some problems. So he said, I wish that he would. That person that's causing all this problem that I was hitting. The other thing that Moses was guilty of. Anybody remember anything else Moses was guilty of? He dishonored the people of God and he called them what? Rebels. Yeah. he showed disrespect in referring to the people of God. He called them out of their name, rebels and stuff like that. And those were about the only thing that's recorded that Moses was actually guilty of. But that was enough to keep him out of what? That means God does not what? Play.
He does play.
He has a law, and if you don't keep that law, what the consequences that you have to face if you don't want to keep the law.
Yep.
He doesn't make any allowances. He'll forgive you, right? He'll have mercy, but he doesn't make any allowances for his law. Amen. If you break them, then you have to what? Get it together, get it right. He ain't gonna change his law. Man, you can't break his law. The law might break you. But God ain't gonna what? Break his law. Amen. It's just like the law of the law is just like the law of electricity. Y'all heard about the baby that was his mother had him in the bathtub and she had an electric stove, a heater that was around, you know, furnishing heat in the bathroom. The baby was in the water, and the baby just grabbed, you know, bent over and put his hands on the electric heater. He was electrocuted. See, a law was right. You can't really alter the law. And the only thing that can alter laws is what the supernatural faith. And God can reverse laws and keep his laws from. But a law is a law. And the Bible says, causeless, you see, the curse causeless shall what? Shall that come? Something like that. Okay, so I've heard a lot of instances in which, y'all heard me tell a story of these twins that were sick, and the mother, it was late at night, she had just come from the doctor's office and got medication for them. She had the medication on the table, but one side of the table, she had a bottle that contained poison. And the other one had the medication. So she got up at night, didn't have no light, so she reached and got the poison and administered that to her babies. Two of them, they were very ill, and both of them died. And as a result, she got so upset until she later on, within the same time frame, she died too. So it was just three graves right together. That was a mistake. Law of chemistry. Law is a law. You can't break God's law. You know, to make any allowances. But you know, if you break God's law, you're going to have to what? Work with whatever God tells you to do in order to come back into harmony with Him. But usually the consequences still remain. Like a person kills somebody, go to prison, and God will forgive them, right? Right? You're going to have to what? You're going to have to what? Pay the price. A law is a law. How many times have we got stopped by a patrolman? Law is a law. We used to get these warning tickets, but they don't probably do those no more, do they? They're hungry for money now. The law is a law, so they don't make no allowances. So
ignorance is no excuse.
That's right. So ignorance is no excuse. Amen. So that's the thing about, you know, God today. He doesn't make any allowances for sin. But if you sin, you know, God has given you a way out, but yet most times you still have to pay what? The consequences. Is that right?
Yeah.
There are repercussions. Poor David, that one sin of the sheep, to cause all of that stuff to happen, a ripple effect throughout his family. His daughter got raped. During the morning prayer, and we will see if the Lord wants us to do something. 48 hours or 72. All right.
I have a, of the fish that he made.
Okay, all right.
But I didn't break it. I went through it, but by Wednesday,
right.
I wanted some fried chicken so bad. I smelled it. No restaurant nowhere around, but I was smelling fried chicken. That was rough, but I made it through the whole week without no meat.
Your flesh playing games on you there.
Yeah.
Your flesh will play games on
you. The devil trying to see, okay, I know she loves chicken. Just let me sit
there
and
roll
about how
things you have eaten a long time and ordinarily you wouldn't even want it. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden you have a craving for that. Mm-hmm. Amen. Okay, well, there's a will, there's a way. We can do all things through Christ. That's true. She gave a good testimony today, Sister Butler. Did she give a good testimony? Y'all heard her? It was good. Right. She's on fire for the Lord. I'm glad to see how God is blessing her home. All right, George, have you ever been filled with the Holy Ghost? With the sign of the evidence of speaking in tongues? Okay. You pray the Spirit? Okay, well, I'm just coming out and helping this week. Come out and help me pray the Spirit. The other morning, you were sitting back there with Judd. I don't know why you were so far back.
Oh, that was back then.
All right, let's also pray for them. Amen. All right, we pray, amen. We can go, Father, we thank you today that your grace is sufficient and you're able to keep that which we are committed into your hands against that day. We give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Any kind of challenge, God, we want you to lay on the altar.